Enter, rejoice, and come in. Enter, rejoice, and come in. Today will be a joyful day. Enter, rejoice, and come in. Enter, rejoice, and come in. Enter, rejoice, and come in. Today will be a joyful day. Enter, rejoice, and come in.
Enter, rejoice, and come in, or enter, rejoice, and log in if you are joining us on Zoom. My name is Allie Peters. I am the assistant minister here at the fellowship. We come together by the light of our chalice flame. If you are joining us from home, we invite you to light a candle or a chalice along with us as we say these words together that we say each week. We light this flame as a symbol of new life, enlightening our way, as a symbol of the warmth in every human heart. Let the lighting of this flame rekindle in us the inner light of hope, of peace, of love. May we share that light with all people.
I'm Alex France, and I've been attending the Unitarian Universalist Fellowship for about 3 years now, and I'm delighted to serve as a worship leader. I love the fellowship because of the curiosity and openness. It seems like every time I come to the fellowship, I'm exposed to new ideas, a different way of life, and my thinking gets broadened just a little bit. So that's why I love the fellowship. If this is your first time visiting the fellowship, I want to extend to you a special welcome. We would love to get connected here. You can talk with any of our staff after the service or send us an email. Today we welcome Reverend Karon Sandberg. She is a retired hospice chaplain who often shares the lessons her patients taught her about how to live. In retirement, she has been working on a book about these lessons, as well as finding new ways in which to stretch herself and use her gifts. She speaks monthly at various UU congregations in our area and in other states. She and her spouse, Joel, enjoy hiking, biking, and kayaking around our beautiful state. And maybe you've seen them at live music venues in town. Their children, Derek and Claire, are adulting in ways that seem pretty cool in Chicago and Washington, D.C. We also want to offer a big thank you to Pat Mitchell, who is filling in our AV booth this morning. Thank you, Pat. Just a note, there is a small change in your order of service. Our special music will lead right into Reverend Karon's sermon with no reflection in between. And a couple regular reminders. The locations of the exits are to your right and left and behind you to your right. And please remember to silence all cell phones. It's time now to settle in, take a breath, become aware of your body wherever you are. Allow yourself to be fully present to this time together. We're glad you're here. Our call to gather excerpts from The Church Incarnate by Reverend Elizabeth Mount. Come into this place, bringing all you hold with you through your heart, be heavily burdened, though your heart be heavily burdened. Whether you be on the brink of tears or burned with unquenchable rage, this community can hold you and your strongest emotions. Yes, even the messy ones are welcome here. Come into this place with every piece of yourself gathered up, and let us be the church incarnate. Let us bring forth the spirit of all that we love by the words of our mouths and the doing of our hands, as we make sacred this time together. Come, let us worship together.
Today we are exploring our aspiration for compassion, our aspiration. We're exploring it as a foundation of our faith. And another foundation of our faith is the foundation of generosity. We take time each week to practice this foundation together, to strengthen our ability to give as we are able, and to receive when we are in need. If you are ever in need of emotional, spiritual, or financial support, we are here for you. Please do not hesitate to reach out to myself or anyone on staff at the fellowship. They'll be able to connect you to assistance, and it is a joy to be able to offer help on behalf of this beloved community. If you're someone who is feeling stable and able to give this morning, we ask that you do so with a spirit of generosity. There are many ways to give to the fellowship. You can give of your time and talent, and we do especially need financial resources to allow our ministries to thrive in the months and years to come. If you're here in our building, feel free to come to the back of the room to one of our ushers, or you can raise your hand to have an usher come to you in order to give. And anyone is also welcome to donate online via our text to give function on a smartphone. Thank you. Your gifts are deeply appreciated. Another important part of our commitment to each other is to bring our joys and our concerns here to this time together. Taking time to honor the joys, concerns, and transitions in our lives, it allows us to share with each other so that our joys might feel multiplied and our sorrows divided. In a moment, we will share those joys and concerns that have been submitted to us by people in our circle of care. And if you are joining us on Zoom, you are also welcome to share in the chat box whatever joy or concern or intention or prayer request is on your heart or on your mind. We also invite anyone here in the building after the service to join a member of our care team at the back of the sanctuary by the bowl of stones if you are in need of a listening presence. For care and connection during the week, please reach out to myself or a member of our care team or, again, anyone on our staff. And if you'd like to include your news in our spoken joys and concerns or in our weekly joys and concerns email, feel free to contact anyone on staff or fill out our website form. We now turn the attention to the joys and concerns wider than those of this gathered community. We allow our minds and our hearts to reach out in ever-widening circles, outward like ripples in water. Our first stone this morning is for our country, as this week the Supreme Court overturned Roe v. Wade, upending 50 years of access to abortion in this country. We come together in our grief, in all of our feelings, in anger, in fear, in heartache at what this means. We speak out as a religious voice. In the words of UU Minister Reverend Ashley Huron, Our theology declares that we are each born with the twin gifts of agency and conscience, that our bodies are sacred and every body is sacred, that our ability to create family in the way that we want to, when we want to, how we want to, is a part of our growth as spiritual beings and as community, and that our liberation is bound up together. None of us are free until all of us are free. This is our theology. We hold all tenderly through this news, and we commit ourselves to the loving fight for reproductive justice. Our second stone this morning is for our UU faith community. Many Unitarian Universalists have been gathered in Portland, Oregon, and online this week for the Unitarian Universalists Association of Congregations Annual General Assembly. Those gathered have been building relationships across congregations, voting on matters of administration, organizing for justice, sharing wisdom and learnings, and visioning a future for our faith. With gratitude for this assembly that strives to value all voices, and with gratitude for the leadership in our UU movement, we send blessings and love to all gathered, and we lift up the hope and joy that emanates from their work. We enfold all who are celebrating and all who are suffering in the embrace of our hearts, and we commit ourselves to acts of compassion and justice in service to those circles beyond our own. May this moment of silence help make it so.
Good morning. As we turn our attention to our settling song today, it's How Could Anyone, 1053 in the Teal Hymnal. Reverend Karon and I were talking about this song in context of the service and noticing that when we sing it, usually we center ourselves, right? And we think about how could that person have treated me that way? And in today's service, we're thinking about it other-directed, right? As we look at people that we are having a hard time making peace with, that we want to punch in the face, as she said in the sermon, seeing their inherent worth and dignity too. So as we invite you to sing this with us, imagine someone else.
All right, so if you, as you were able, please rise and we'll sing hymn 1053 in the Teal Hymnal. And the words are on the screen if you want to just follow along. Tell you, you're anything less than beautiful. How could anyone ever tell you, you were less than whole? How could anyone fail to notice that your loving is a miracle? How deeply you're connected to my soul. How could anyone ever tell you you were anything less than beautiful? How could anyone ever tell you you were less than whole? How could anyone fail to notice that
that your loving is a miracle. How deeply you're connected to my soul.
Good morning. It's always a joy to be back up here again, so I'm having fun seeing all your faces. I suspect that many of us are angry today, devastated by the Supreme Court's decision. And I have to confess, I'm concerned that the rawness of that anger may make what I will be saying today difficult for some of you to hear. My wish is that you'll still listen. And perhaps you'll hold my words for reflection when that rawness subsides. Our first reading is by author John Pavlovitz. Nothing adequately explains a complete rejection of science. Nothing completely accounts for instantly embracing the most nonsensical of conspiracies. Nothing truly prepares us for the social media explosions of racism. Nothing fully connects the dots between past goodnesses that were real, and what now seems like only ugliness. You could microscopically parcel out every conceivable contributing factor: white supremacy, the pro-life movement, the 24-hour news cycle, toxic masculinity, evangelical indoctrination, intellectual laziness, manipulated nationalism, unchecked capitalism, political fatigue, and probably the biggest one, fear. But they fail to adequately explain how I lost people, people I loved and respected. Those possible factors don't cushion the pain of these separations. They don't make it easier for me to grieve the loss of living people. They don't comfort me in these relational funerals. And as much as I am in mourning, I know that these people are similarly mourning me. They too are lamenting their own list of ways they think I've changed or lost the plot or abandoned my convictions or betrayed my religion. And they're wondering where they lost me to. Our second reading is an adaptation of A Blessing by John O'Donohue. When the gentleness between you and another hardens, and when you fall out with each other, may the depths that you have reached hold you still. When it feels like not a true word can be said or even heard, when you mirror each other in the script of hurt, when even the silence between you has become raw and torn, may you look back and recall the echo of your first music together. When the weaving of your life starts to unravel and anger sears the ground between you, before the weather of grief invites the black seeds of bitterness to find root, may your souls pause and instead choose to listen. Now is the time for you to be gracious, to allow a kindness that is beyond hurt and thought. Reach out with sure hands. Take the chalice of your love and carry it carefully through this angry wasteland until this dark winter pilgrimage leads you both together toward the growth and change of spring.
It's a still life watercolor, of a now late afternoon, and the sun shines through the curtain lace, and shadows wash the room. And we sit and drink our coffee, couched in our indifference like shells upon the shore. You can hear the ocean roar in the dangling conversation and the superficial sighs. Yeah, the borders of our lives.
And I read my Emily Dickinson,
and I my Robert Frost, as the sun and the bookmarkers that measure what we've lost. Like a poem poorly written, we are verses out of rhythm, couplets out of rhyme, in syncopated time. And the dangling conversation and the superficial sighs are the borders of our lives. Yes, we speak of things that matter with words that must be said. Can analysis be worthwhile? Is the theater really dead? And now the room is soft and faded. I can only kiss your shadow. I cannot feel your hand. You're a stranger now unto me, lost in the dangling conversation and the superficial sighs and the borders of our lives.
A few weeks after the January 6th insurrection at the United States Capitol, Rabbi Ariel Berger met with members of the Witness Institute. Rabbi Berger studied with author, professor, and Nobel laureate Elie Wiesel, and they formed the Institute to help high-potential leaders influence their communities to help build a loving and more moral world. The participants that morning shared feelings of fear, confusion, righteousness, and anger. It was clear that even within the group, there was a lot of political diversity. During their meeting, the discussions had become heated. There was no consensus or resolution falling into place as he had hoped. Rabbi Berger was shaken, and he was unsure of what to do. He had 4 minutes to wrap up their time together. Nothing felt right. In fact, things felt very wrong. He stepped up to the podium and he surprised them all by asking them to join him in song. He taught them a simple Hasidic melody, wordless but beautiful. As their voices blended together, the whole mood shifted. The tensions in the room evaporated. The members of the Institute reported that even though they held to different ideas, singing together reminded them that they were one. Rabbi Berger recalled his teacher, Rabbi Nachman, had told him once that when two people are talking at the same time, it is cacophony. But when two people sing together, it's harmony. I've been rolling this sermon around in my head for over a year now, and maybe you found the title alarming. I kept thinking I should call it something a little bit less aggressive, but every time I talked with anyone about it, they said, oh no, you have to call it that, because that's exactly how I feel. If you've read any polls about our country, the word you hear the most is division. We have become a divided nation. I feel it. I've been angry. I've been frustrated. And I feel like I'm losing hope for our country, our communities, and God forbid, even some of my own family members. I've been wrestling with how I can walk with integrity within all of this. And I confess sometimes it feels like I can't. So I stand before you this morning trying to sort this out. I wouldn't be too surprised if many of you are feeling similarly, a bit lost, a little scared, and unsure of which way to go. Truthfully, I feel like I live in a UU cocoon. My social media sends me stories about the other side that only help to fuel my disdain in support of my own leanings. My friends and colleagues join me in articles and actions seeking similar outcomes. But then after something like the insurrection, or people denying science, or our racist history, or our government making decisions about women's reproductive health, or people saying they're pro-life and then doing nothing to protect our children from gun violence, I gotta confess, I feel like I'm at the end of my rope. I'm an ordained minister, for God's sakes. If I'm struggling, no wonder the rest of the country is ready to throw in the towel. Reverend Nadia Boltz Weber says, "I do not think our psyches were developed to hold and feel and respond to everything coming at us right now, every tragedy, injustice, sorrow, and natural disaster that's happening across the planet in real time, every minute of every day. Before technology allowed us to hold the world in our hand, before television invaded almost every space imaginable, the human heart and spirit were able to hold and respond to tragedy that happened in our village." She says she feels like her emotional circuit breaker keeps overloading because the hardware for it was built for an older time. It feels about right that my circuit breakers are overloaded. Dr. Amy Arnston, a professor of neuroscience and psychology at Yale Medical School, says that when we are bombarded with all of these things, we lose the very circuits that allow us to self-regulate, to be rational, and in many ways, how not to be irritable. I want to offer love and compassion to the other, to the stranger, to my neighbor, but I confess the patience and compassion I used to have has thinned mightily. I feel this close to wanting to punch some people in the face sometimes. But of course, I don't. I know that's not a solution, and trust me, I am not advocating for that. But I confess I used to have more layers of compassion and patience. It took a lot to make me feel the anger and the unrest that is so close to the surface for me now. A friend of mine, when feeling overwhelmed and unable to cope, would say, "My give a damn just got broke." And I get that these days. In this past year, due to vaccines and boosters, I've reconnected with friends and groups that I had not physically seen in the previous year. Within these groups, I found myself having a lot of the same conversations as we got together. Maybe you found this too. Conversations centered around our disbelief of the other side. And I realized there was a certain pleasure to these conversations. When I got together with other like-minded people, we would marvel about the stupidity of the other, how ridiculous and selfish and thoughtless they were. In turn, it reaffirmed our own choices and made us feel better about who we were. But after a while, I began to realize how stupid, ridiculous, selfish and thoughtless I had now become when I reveled in that kind of behavior. In her book, Atlas of the Heart, Dr. Brené Brown gives us a deeper language for understanding our feelings and emotions. She believes the words we choose have power. Language can be used to strip people of their dignity and humanity. She warns that both sides of the aisle are now using language that is dehumanizing. When I read these words, I saw myself. When I read these words, I was shocked to realize that I and my friends were using words to dehumanize the other. Brené Brown says that it seems the only thing that binds us together now is shared fear and disdain, not common humanity, not shared trust or love. Acknowledging this behavior with him and myself feels awful. I wonder if you've had those thoughts too. I'm better than that. You are better than that. As a denomination, we are better than that. But in these divided times, is it even possible to find our way back to one another? With a very deep breath, and with my mind filled with 100 reasons why we can't, the truth is that we can, and to be honest, we simply must. So where do we start? First and foremost, I think we start in the way that we want to be seen and we want to be treated. We want to be heard and respected for our beliefs and thoughts. So if this is true, then we must also offer the same to the other. The wise and wonderful Elie Wiesel said, "We should never let anyone be humiliated in our presence." This makes me reflect on our first Unitarian Universalist principle, that we believe in the inherent worth and dignity of every person. And I confess that's been a hard one for me lately. Does this mean I have to believe in the worth and dignity of someone who denies science, that believes in unfounded conspiracy theories? Our second principle says, we believe in justice, equality, and compassion. Compassion in all human relations. All human relations. Not just people we like. That's a hard one too. Am I supposed to feel compassion for those who I feel are acting unethically? Our third principle says we believe in a free and responsible search for truth and meaning, even if someone else's truth and meaning is different than our own. Let's be honest, as Unitarian Universalists, we should especially embrace someone whose truth and meaning is different from ours. Because isn't that why we gathered and formed this faith association in the first place? Because we felt outside of the teachings and beliefs of leaders and members of century-old religious institutions. If we look back into our history, we find martyrs who were killed for believing something so opposed by the majority of society. Unitarians doubted the Trinitarian structure of God that was created by Constantine and the Council of Nicaea. Universalists believed everyone would be saved. Those two thoughts were once heresy, and for many faith traditions today, they still are. And yet we sit here today, holding those ideas as part of our faith story. Our denomination was on the forefront of allowing women to be ordained and speak from the pulpit decades before other denominations did, and many still don't. Our denomination was one of the first to ordain and openly welcome LGBTQ ministers and congregants, recognizing the importance and holiness of their lives and their words. We should be good at this. We should be leaders in accepting the other. But I stand before you right now as proof that it's still very, very hard to do. Rabbi Ariel Berger says there's two challenges as we face the other. One is that we fall into the trap of simply not listening to them. And then second, we believe we are overfamiliar with the other. We think we already know them. I'm guilty of this. When I hear that someone supported certain candidates or policies, I feel an emotional wall go up inside myself. I wouldn't humiliate them, but I admit I feel myself mentally walking away from them as they speak. I fall into that trap of believing that I already know them. And truthfully, it feels challenging to me to think that some folks right here in this room might disagree with some of my thoughts. But the reality is, they already are. You and I, we can't know everything everyone thinks or embraces. Admit it, we all select bits and pieces of both sides of the aisle to create our own way of being and understanding the world. Nothing is ever just black or white. Or better yet, no one is just blue or red. And outside these four walls, how many of us have members of our own family who hold to things we dare not embrace? Let me see a show of hands. For those of you at home, almost everyone raised their hands. I have a family member who I love that allows conservative media to influence his thoughts and drive his choices, and I find it a bit scary and irrational, and I feel he holds to things that press up against my desire for a loving and caring society. It's hard to be around him. Like John Pavlovich said in our earlier reading, it feels like a living death, like a relationship funeral. In the podcast on being with Krista Tippett, she and Rabbi Berger explored how we can bring our hearts, our hands, and our feet into all of this division and see it as an opportunity for learning and renewal, where we can really encounter something that will change us. But do we want that? Are we open to that? I think hearing that we need to change may be the hardest thing to grasp. How can we change? Rabbi Berger says we do it by practicing deep listening and deep respect. He invites us not to shut down or run away when we encounter someone who disagrees with us, but instead to make room for them, to not turn away, but to make room for them. He believes there's something sacred in their position, that there's something for us to learn in that position without collapsing all of our thoughts and into our own preconceived stereotypical thoughts of what we think they believe or stand for. This got me thinking about asking deeper questions of the other. Instead of attacking the other's politics, it got me to wondering what may have happened over time for them that has made them find meaning in their current ideas. Have I ever asked that? Truth be told, I never had. What would happen if I paused and asked deeper questions? For me, this approach opens us up more to love and less to anger and defensiveness. Rabbi Berger points out that in a healthy relationship, our job is less to transform the other than to attend to ourselves. Elie Wiesel said, past wrongs could be tools of education rather than tools of humiliation for all of us, not just for those who we think have it wrong. And this comes from a man who survived the Holocaust. Past wrongs could be tools of education rather than tools of humiliation. Yikes, those words hit close to home, don't they? How often as parents or partners have we lifted up past mistakes or as a way to shame or humiliate even our loved ones? How often do we lift up the mistakes of the other side's politicians as they drag out the mistakes of ours? We do it all the time. Rabbi Berger invites us to take a look at the very first relationship that we've heard stories about, Adam and Eve. The Bible says Eve was created from Adam to be a help meet for him. In the Hebrew translation, it is not helpmate, it is help meet, which is actually a very different word. Help, of course, meaning helper, but meet means one who is against him. Rabbi Berger says, to understand this idea of otherness, one of the best things you can do for me, one of the best ways you can help me in my own search for truth, is to confront me with your different perspective, your different opinion, your different take on things. And yet in these troubling times, we've stopped doing that. It's like we do not want to even open the door for another perspective anymore. We've already decided that I am right and you are wrong. So holding all this, I went to talk with my family member, the one I find myself distancing from. I decided to really listen and not let stereotypical thoughts color my thinking. I remained quiet, and I just listened. I heard a lot about fear. Fear about being in a world that no longer made sense to him. And I thought, I feel that way too. I heard a lot about losses and feelings of being labeled an enemy in a country that he loves. I heard common sense worries about fiscal responsibility and worries about folks who manipulate the system. I heard about feeling disregarded. And then once he had released how the pain of those things felt, the discussion suddenly shifted. I began to hear about wishes for a better world, for good schools, jobs, and safe neighborhoods for everyone. I heard about a desire for all of us to treat one another with respect, and how he understood that we really are all connected. I was surprised to hear wishes for some of the very things I wanted too, from someone I thought was out to destroy them. Rabbi Berger says, the practice of never letting anyone be humiliated in your presence is a very powerful starting point. It means that not only should you not humiliate someone, but that you also cannot be indifferent. You can't be a bystander. You have now become a witness. I was a witness to my family member's pain and frustration. He was also a witness to my feelings. And in that act of witnessing, I found hope. In that act of witnessing, I found a renewal of faith in who we were to one another. But here's the catch. We can make space for the other, but we're not guaranteed that the other will make space for us. And hearing that, some of you may say, well, screw that. I deserve the same respect and offering. Perhaps. But the truth is, we can't change anyone. We can only change ourselves. And I don't know about you, but I am tired of being so angry. I want to feel hope again. I see now that I need to change how I choose to be in this world. Author and teacher Suzanne Stabile asks us to consider, what's mine to do and what's not mine to do? What's mine to say and what's not mine to say? And the third one she lifts up to me is even harder. What's mine to care about? And what's not mine to care about? She recognizes that our effectiveness in the world cannot extend to every single event or situation. It's not an issue of values, it's an issue of math. So she tries to remember, number one, we're still living through a global pandemic, and that means anxiety and grief are higher than ever. Number two, the world is on fire, literally and metaphorically. But three, we only have so much water in our own buckets to help with the fire. And if we have no water to fight, the more likely we will get burned. So she says she tries to tell herself that it's okay to focus on one or two fires. It's okay to do what is yours to do. Say what's yours to say. Care about what's yours to care about. For me, this focuses me on being intentional about how we choose to use our water. It can help us not to overload our circuits. And gratefully, we all have different interests. All of us here have different concerns that we're willing to use our water for. In this room, I know many of you use your bucket of water to help the environment. Others use their water to help the homeless or the hungry. And I know that there will be many of you wanting to use your water to help women have access to safe abortions if needed. Knowing this gives me hope. It does take a village, and in that village, we are not alone, but we are surrounded by people with their own buckets of water. Rabbi Berger says that hope is the first moral choice. It's the first thing that allows us to stay in the game and continue to do the work in our corner. But if we give up, if we get buried in this anger, and we continue to allow ourselves to dehumanize each other, it's over. But if instead we listened, deeply listened, and we provide witness to the pain and suffering the other is feeling too, then we could reimagine together. And it brings us back around to holding this truth, that when two people are talking at once, it is cacophony. But when two people sing together, it's harmony. Poet and writer Mark Nepo shares a scientific fact that when two living heart cells from two different people are placed into a petri dish, those cells in time will find and maintain a third and common beat. I've shared this before in my sermons, and I do it again because I believe it to be so profound. He says that this biological fact holds the secret to all relationships. It is scientific proof that beneath any resistance that we may have, there is in the very nature of life itself an essential joining force. This force makes compassion possible, even probable. For if two cells can find a common pulse, how much more can two full hearts feel together when all of our excuses fall away? In this life, I believe we've been given the sacred tasks to make our hearts bigger, not smaller. If two different heart cells can find a third and common beat, so can we. May it be so.
Our hymn today is 1023, Building Bridges. It's in the teal hymnal, and the lyrics are up here as well. We're going to do this in two phases. So phase one is, let's all sing it together in unison. I'll play it through once, and then please join me. Please stand. And let's sing together.
Building bridges between our divisions, I reach out to you and you reach out to me. With all of our voices and all of our visions, friends, we could make such sweet harmony.
One more time, and.
Building bridges between our divisions, I reach out to you and you reach out to me. With all of our voices and all of our visions, friends, we could make such sweet harmony.
And now we'll do phase two, which is harmony, not cacophony. So Joel's going to start this half, and then two measures later, we're going to come in. So as we say, around, right? So Joel, go ahead, and we're going to each group sing it through three times. So we're going to finish a little bit after they finish. I'm going to join this
ready?
Mic.
Good, ready?
Building bridges between
Here we go.
Our divisions.
And?
I
building bridges between our divisions.
With
I reach out to you. Will you reach out to me?
Visions.
With
friends,
all of our voices and all of our visions, friends, we could make such sweet harmony. Second time.
Building bridges between our divisions.
I reach out to you.
Will you reach out to me?
With all of our voices and all of our visions,
friends, we can break such sweet harmony.
Third time.
Building bridges between our divisions.
I reach out to you.
Will you reach out to me?
With all of our voices and all of our visions, friends, we could make such sweet harmony. I wanted to take a moment as a staff member to honor this special, yes, that's the spirit, to honor this special moment of sending Allie out into the world as a minister. It has been a joy and a blessing to get to work with Allie. We were talking together, and Cindy, our office secretary, said that the first time she met you in person, you were visiting a llama, an alpaca farm. And one of the alpacas was angry at the other one and spat at it, but got Allie multiple times. And Cindy did one of those like hot takes, like, what's it gonna, and Allie just brushed it off and laughed, and Allie was like, I can work with this person. So. And I just wanted to say, Allie and I made a lot of distant, like, Zoom videos together, and such a pro. I could tell immediately that you had taught middle school, that nothing was gonna faze you at this point. And so we'd do some silly bits, and I would not be memorized, and you would, and I'd be like, okay, the game is higher now. It has just been, you get to see the great sermons, you get to see the great compassion and caretaking and pastoral care, but you're also truly ready to work and run your own congregation, and it has just been such a blessing. So we are, of course, celebrating Allie today. After the service, please join us in the fellowship hall. I'm told there's cake. That's the word on the street. So if you would please join me one last time in thanking Allie in the service here. You've got this, Allie.
Will be missed, Allie, let me tell you. Our time together is coming to a close, which means our time to return to the world and to our daily lives is beginning. Remember that there are always ways to get connected here, even online, and to live your faith more fully. Be sure to read the weekly scroll, e-newsletter, or let us know if you want to be added to that mailing list. Check out the order of service for some highlights about what's coming up. So I laid some heavy stuff on you. We invite you now to consider something from today's service that you want to carry with you, away from this place and into your week. Maybe a phrase or a topic, a song or something else. It's our hope that it will provide inspiration and empowerment for you until we are together again.
Thank you all. Now please join me in our unison words for extinguishing our chalice flame. Even as we continue to hold its light and its warmth in our hearts. As we extinguish this flame, let us go our ways with hope in our hearts, with our spirits renewed, and with a deeper understanding of life's mystery. Let us carry the light of compassion and commitment to build a better world. And with that, go with the aspiration of compassion. Go in peace, knowing that this place waits to embrace you upon your return.
How could anyone ever tell you you were anything less than beautiful? How could anyone ever tell you you were less than whole? How could anyone fail to notice that your loving is a miracle? How deeply you're connected to my soul. How could
than beautiful. How could anyone